So I'm pleased to be there today to introduce you Barrel. A real introduction this time, because this is release day. This is a month of works that are coming public. So just to quickly introduce myself, I'm generally doing consulting, mostly in Erlang, some Python also, and any distributed architecture. I'm working in my own solo company, and I'm working mostly in the world. So today I will introduce you Barrel, and the plan today is to present you quickly what is Barrel, which is grown from from a fork of CouchDB to lately rewrite everything from scratch and remove all the dumps that have been accumulated over the years. So we will see what is building an Erlang database in Erlang and actually doing it fully based on the actual model. And then we will see the pluggable backends that we put on that, the pluggable storage backend. So we have RocksDB today that is implemented, but you have also a Amnesia backend, which is not public yet. And you have also a React backend that is started to be used by some people. And then I will show you, hopefully, a demo, if the Wi-Fi allows that. Of the brand new code, which is very alpha release and which is public today. I will show you the links later. So the vision and concept of Barrel. The main goal of Barrel is not to build a database like the other. We don't care mostly about querying. If people want to query the data in Barrel, they can plug to Barrel any change fits, and they can query it using Elasticsearch or NSQL database, or whatever they want to. We are mostly focusing on replication and data exchange between different places. For the history, Barrel grown from being a fork of CouchDB, started for customers, then for two, then for three, then for four customers. They were all doing the same things, having some small nodes in different places. Some people were doing events in some place, and they have two or three nodes, like for example in the Erlang factory, you could have three or four nodes around the place where people connect with their mobile and start to exchange data, replicate the data. Why using something like CouchDB or now today Barrel? It's because when you are coming back to your hotel, or when you are taking a boat, for example, or when, like today, the Wi-Fi is going down, then you will continue to exploit the data that you have on your mobile or on your computer, continue to edit the data, and then when you come back online, share it. And sometimes people have also edited the same documents, the same data, then you will have conflicts. And the main challenge of Barrel is how to solve conflicts. We don't solve that automatically, mostly, like any CRDT or stuff like this. We also have a convergence algorithm. We are doing CRDT are not really new, and convergence algorithms are not really new. Actually, the algorithm of Barrel is based on the hash histories, which is an algorithm that's grown in the early 80s. So data is mobile, and the full concept is on this diagram. So you may have a local database in place, you may have a database on the cloud, could be Amazon, could be Azure, or whatever you want to. And you have another database on another place, so for example in Paris and New York, and then in Stockholm and in Japan, whatever. They are all connected each other, they are all replicating each other, they can all go down, the network can go down at some points. People can continue to edit the data, and when come back online, then the data are replicated automatically to the other nodes. And conflicts are also replicated, so even if you have some basic logic that can automate the conflicts resolution, you can say later, I will take all my conflicts and I want a better solution for that. And I will show up my conflicts and fix it. This is fully P2P. We don't have any bottlenecks. You can introduce bottlenecks if you want to in the discovery. For some customers, we have the discovery done using a simple file shared on Amazon S3. For the other one, we have we are using UDP broadcasting, so nodes are automatically discovered over UDP, and then the replication is started. Stuff like this. And you can share it. As of today, there is no pure native barrel mobile library, but it's coming. But you can use Couchbase Lite or PouchDB, like CouchDB, if you want to. We are very optimized for Couchbase Lite, since we are able to replicate using their optimized algorithm, replication algorithm. We are local first. So some people say we are doing the offline first database, etc. But offline doesn't mean really some things. We are about local database, meaning we have data. We may have a big silo, a big barrel of data at some points, but you won't replicate everything on your mobiles. You won't replicate everything on your new car. Either way, you will filter the data that you have in this big silo and take the data that you want to. An example comes to my mind. I consulted for the customs, the French customs, some years ago. And they, we experimented the replication over our couch, and over a big couch at that time. So the main goal was you have the data on the two big clusters, and they were replicated to small offices around the around France. At least it was the main goal of that. So you will have this big silo on which every local office would be replicating the data, and then one office will take only a set of data, a view on the data. And what's barrel? So I already talked a lot of that. Just to wrap up, we are focused on the replication. We organize the data in a way so we can you can replicate it, them efficiently between machine and people. This is a document-oriented database, meaning you can replicate JSON documents or something similar to a JSON structure. Could be also very soon multipack or even the binary terms if you want to. You can replicate in both ways between nodes. We have no slave, no master, whatever the terminology you want to. We are doing push-pull between nodes. In both ways, you can do simultaneous replications. This is fully P2P. You just have to link one node to the other node, start your replication task, and eventually do some chain replication, meaning if you want to replicate to three nodes, like something you can do when you want to shard your data, and make sure that your data is backup on three places, you can start the replication on one node and wait on the last node of the chain that the replication ends and the data came on that place, and then come back. Already text. Behind everything on that, just to explain rapidly how it will work in a database, we have two kind of index. So you are storing any data, actually documents, but could be blobs. In a database file or in a database as a key value. And you have mainly two indexes. One is the ID index, allowing you to retrieve the document by their ID. And you have another index that indexes them by sequence. This is mostly a way to replay all the data that came in your database and get all the change fields to another node. And the replication is based on that. This is nothing new. It allows you to retrieve any revision that came to a database. We never delete the data. All the data are appended or added to the database. And then you get the logs. You get all the revision using the logs and all the conflicts. On top of that, like you see, in the index, we are storing metadata, and we are only storing metadata. And this metadata is mostly a revision tree. We are storing all the history of the document as a tree. So each branch represents a conflict. So if you have data that came on one node is edited, you continue to edit using the last revision you have a new machine, then you continue to increase to increase the branch. And if someone is doing the same edit at some point, it will start a new branch, just like Git. It will be started automatically in that case for that document, and then continue to increase on that branch. And this is how conflicts are stored. And then all the main objective later is to go over the tree and start to remove the conflicts. Like I said, we are not deleting everything. So to solve the conflicts, you take a branch and you mark it. You mark the if you want to delete that branch, you create a new record on that branch, marking it as deleted. And then for the algorithm, it will be removed later from the history. We don't remove everything. We are keeping the deleted mark, so it's replicated, and so other nodes will know that you have deleted that branch. I said that normally revisions are removed, and this is the case in CouchDB. You have limits of 10,000 documents, but in some case you don't want to delete that document, that revision, because for security reason, like if you are in a bank, you have to keep your data for at least 15 years in some country, 20 years in another country, like in Switzerland. And then you want to keep all the history. And as I already said, we are not a database. We are focusing on the data replication. We are basing all the data on the replication. And then we are providing to the customers some tools that allows you to take a part of history and put it on a cold storage, for example. And then when you want to go back on that revision tree later, you take that history back and retrieve that and maybe fix that conflict that happened 10 years ago in your document. This is compatible with PouchDB, cache-based light. For now, it can be embedded in Elixir. We have a student during the GSOC, the Google Summer of Code, that worked a lot of Elixir integration in Barrel. And the last result was this library that allows you to compile Elixir and embed it directly in your Erlang code, which is not that easy as it appeared at the first perspective, because you have to embed all the library from Elixir, but also to have to start Elixir in the right way, and the loggers, etc. And this library is doing that for you. We have other abstraction in Barrel, so it can be embedded. The current code in Barrel in GitHub can be embedded directly in Elixir and started in to be used in Elixir in Elixir code. And the new code will be also be used directly in Elixir. So everything is done in Erlang, even if we have some C code. The C code is mostly for the storage provider. For example, we have RocksDB, but you can have later maybe LevelDB, or you can have SophiaDB, or any database you want to, depending on which logic you want to have. In the storage, if you want to store it more in memory, or if you want to store it more in SSD, or if you want to store it in RIAC and then take RIAC as a way to have a big silo of your data and replicate it on an internal cluster, it's completely pluggable. So we have many challenges to create a database in Erlang. The main challenge is how to have concurrent writers and concurrent readers. We can't rely like we can do if we are building a database in Rust or in Go or in C++ or in C or even in Java. We can't rely on locks, because atomic locks, at least at the system level, don't exist. And taking a process as a lock, like anyone does in Erlang, is not that easy and is not as efficient as simple locks on the systems. We have no software transaction memory in Erlang. You can have it in Akka, you can have it in Orleans, in Microsoft Orleans, but not in Erlang. So we only have between code. We only have actors, or sort of. We have only Erlang processes. So we have to find a way to have it, because to have it with the actors. So it's very challenging, because every actor, every process, as you know, are isolated from each other, which is part of the promise of the concurrency promise. But then a process by itself becomes bottlenecks. If you use it like CouchDB do, or like some other database does, if you use it as a way to say, I want all my write comings to that process and all my read coming to that process, then everything will be packed in a message queue, and all the messages will be processed one by one. You can, of course, filter the message in Erlang, but it won't be enough to have a big concurrency. And you will be very limited, not more than 100 requests per second, mostly. This is what can achieve actually in Jabberdee or other or RabbitMQ processes. We have only 100 requests per second max, mostly. Doesn't mean that you can't have many thousand or million requests coming to that process, but they are all packed, waiting to be processed. So you have to be fast in your process. You have to handle that request very fast and return very fast, or having a way to pass it in another manner. I will talk about that later. A lot of people, at least this is since 3 years, a lot of people are taking ETS as a magic way to offload all the processing that you have. So people are putting data in ETS and saying it's faster than processes. Yes, it's faster than processes, but you can also have ETS blocking at some points, blocking the scheduler, and ETS is not magic by itself. Also, you don't have any blockings, and since you don't have any software transaction memory, even there was in 2006 there was a paper about adding software transaction memory in ETS, and you have some kind of way to say I want to insert a data automatically in ETS, or to read that data automatically. But this is not enough for database. We want to make sure that write is entering, and that for that document, and only one can update that document, in that case a barrel, because we want to keep that history. So if someone is editing that document, also we need to make sure that this update will happen in order, or will be written in the tree, in the revision tree. So we need to block at some point, and we need to do that in an efficient manner. So I considered only two models of concurrency. There are other models, I am aware, but only two were good for me. One is to have concurrent writer racing for write. Sorry, there is a typo. Which is called optimistic writing, and basically it means that you have each time you editing a value, you increasing a sequence, and everyone is doing that. And so each time you're writing, you increase a sequence. And when you come the first time you want to edit that data, you take that data and saying to the system, "I'm taking the data," so it will cache the sequence for the data. You edit the documents, you came back, and the system, the process, will compare the sequence between both. And if the sequence are different, it will ask you to try again. And then you enter in a loop. This is actually how works software transaction null memory, basically. But I tried that. It was working for a lot of storage, like we can do that over ETS, we can do that over RocksDB, we can do that over eLevelDB, but we can't do that over RIAC, and we can't do that also over some other storage. You can do it in RIAC if you use their consistent storage, but this is not really efficient. It means for us, it would mean to have a real bottlenecks, having a way to know where the nodes are. So I removed that. The other way is to have one single writer and multiple readers, which is called SWMR. And a lot of databases are doing that, actually. MySQL is doing that, Postgres is doing that, RocksDB is doing that, SQLite is doing that. A lot of databases are doing that because this is simple to do. And this is very appropriate to Erlang too, because then we can have a process on which we will write, and the, having a way to tell to a bunch of other processes that they can read on that. And so you can scale horizontally your database by increasing the number of readers. And want to increase the number of writers, then shard your process and add a new process that will write just a portion of your data. And then you can have a multiple concurrent writes also in parallel. I also do, because I looked at the other actor systems, this is something sometimes I reproach to Erlang. We don't have much more discussion about concurrency and how we can handle actors in Erlang. So when you read the mailing list of Orleans, or when you read the tickets of Orleans or ACA, people are very keenly discussing of making things in actors. They were also discussing about using a concurrent dictionary like we have in ETS. But in Orleans, they removed, they don't use at all a concurrent dictionary. Why? Because a concurrent dictionary is only scalable locally, where if you have processes, in Erlang, if you have actors, then you can have an actor on that machine, and if that machine come overloaded, then you open a new actor on another machine and move the data there, or the connection there. And this is quite more easily to add more actor, more actor if you want load increase. ACA is doing the same. So you have persistent storage in ACA, which is really smart. This is quite even sourcing, so they are storing. You have actors, processes that receive and write, that receive and send. And when on receive, you can say, "I want to store that, persist that message." And later, when your process is restarted, then you can replay all the logs, all the events that came, all the messages that came that were persisted on disk, and recreate your states. Persistence. This is something that is missing in Erlang. In Orleans, this is the same goals. You have the storage providers, which are working less smart in less smart manner than ACA. They are storing from time to time all the state in a persistent storage. Can be as your cloud, it can be a level DB or an SQL database. And they are also doing that using actor. Both systems are using only actor. An E-level database is represented by an actor, actually shared by all the process. And this is the same for Orleans. So you have grains in Orleans, which are kind of chain server or actor in Erlang. And each grains are persisted in the storage. They are all sharing the same storage. And they can retrieve their state by their ID that is stored on the storage. So I decided to take the same path in Erlang because I wasn't very kind of using ETS. I just wanted to use actor, which is very, very easy to persist or to store or to supervise, etc. And then I decided to take that path. So you have one process that maintains the DB state. And this process has only two roles. Is maintaining the link to the writer process, and it's maintaining the links to the reader process, and saying to the reader process where they can read the data. The writer, all the writes are going then to the... So when you want to write, you ask to the DB process about the writer process, it returns you the writer process, then you start to write a new own path to the writer. And the writer is then sending to a pool. This pool is here to increase to simulate the future that you have in other language, or to simulate at least the concurrency, because we have only one storage provider that is shared between all the database. You can have multiple storage providers too. And then the storage provider is hidden behind the pool. All the read and write happen through the pool to the storage provider, and from the storage provider to the pool, then to the reader, and then to the writer. So everything is asynchronous. You can write and read in parallel. No blocking. At least you have a bottleneck. You have this DB state that you can increase, etc. But since the operation is very fast, this is just asking where is my writer and where is my reader, where is my pool. This is very, very fast. And if you want later to play with ETS, you can imagine to have to watch on the DB state and store the state directly in ETS. And if you want to query for the writer in ETS and or query to where to read on the ETS, you will be able to do that. With one problem still, if you are doing that in ETS, there is no guarantee that your process didn't die since you request that. This guarantee is more easy to maintain, to achieve using one process, because it's blocking, you ask, it makes sure that the writer is there, and then you return. The worst thing that can happen is writer died in between. Where in ETS, maybe the writer died and was restarted by the supervisor quite quickly. But ETS, you don't have this information. So you have one jet server that is in the interface, a simple process that logs the write, and one pool to handle the concurrency per storage provider. Storage provider are a simple abstraction. We have only four operations on that storage provider. We have Ryan that is writing the document, and it doesn't do anything that taking the document information, like the sequence you need to update, the ID you need to update, and the full document by itself, the revision, and store it in RocksDB and store it as a key value using an atomic transaction. And the same for read, it just reading a key value, getting the document metadata, and from it, getting the revision you want to, and return that. And then the two other operations are folding the change and folding the IDs, again, by reading key values. So it can be, it's very easy to do a backend if you want to for React or for Postgres or for anything you want to. Storage provider are configured as startup. This is the only way you can change your storage provider actually dynamically, because if you do differently, you can crash the machine. You need to have the storage provider started first, so you can actually do something with your database. So for now, you can discover that on our repository. You have two. We have created. So I started by implementing the snapshot, etc. Over the NIFs provided over RocksDB provided by the LeoFS projects. Then took the code, removed the fork, the LeoFS project of RocksDB was a fork of the LevelDB project from Basho. And it was also taking the same thread pool. Every write and read were going on the thread, on the pool, so you don't lock the scheduler. Which was working, so I started by adding some features I wanted to have, like having a way to make sure that when you read some documents information, I also need to read the revision and make sure that this revision is not deleted. So for that, you have the way in RocksDB, you have the way also in other database to do that, to take a snapshot on your database and do the read on your snapshot. So a snapshot makes sure that none of your data will be deleted in between. So I added some feature, but it was getting very, very complicated to do that, because it was about creating a new worker that were able to go in the thread pools, etc. And then I did that for the snapshot, I did that for the checkpoints, I did that for the backup facility, etc. To have that actually in C, because it's faster than doing that in Erlang. But it was getting complicated, and in the same times we have the .inif that were becoming stable. So I created a new fork of RocksDB, which is Barrel of RocksDB, which is based on .inif. So everything is written using .inif, sharing the IO thread that you have in Erlang. It's working. It's actually working quite well, even more efficient than using the thread pool that you have in LevelDB. The only problem is that if you have more than one storage, they will all store share the same thread pool inside Erlang, because .inif are using also a thread pool to not lock the scheduler, just like IO threads on the other side. So it would be nice if Erlang have a way to set up multiple thread pool directly. The interest of using thread .inif, if I okay, apparently the Wi-Fi doesn't work, so I can't show that. The interest of using the .inif is you can just decorate your function and say this function won't be blocking and have to go to the scheduler, do the task, and return the results. Then you do it magically, mostly magically. You just mark this function need to go in the thread, and I need to retrieve the result asynchronously, just like you were doing with the thread pool, but in an easy manner integrated in Erlang. So I did that for many functions. I rewrote everything for many functions. I did other feature to RocksDB. But we are not using that in the new version, in the new version of Barrel right now, because it's not marked as stable yet in Erlang. And a lot of people complain that they are not able to build their Erlang with .inif, and Erlang solution is not shipping the Erlang distribution with .inif. So for customer or for lazy people, building an Erlang is no way. They won't do that. And if their package manager don't provide them an Erlang version with .inif, they won't use it. So we are back to use the RocksDB, smallly forked for Barrel, but that's all. We are using thread pool. But .inif are very interesting and actually would allow us to add more backend, C backend, very easily to Erlang sides. And so you can discover the new code of Barrel on this GitLab repository. We move from GitHub to GitLab. You have all the code. This is very, very alpha. You have the HTTP API that is barely working. All the functions that you have to get to put documents to retrieve the revision difference between two nodes are working. Change feed is implemented in a branch, but still not yet merged, I think. And this is a full rewrite from scratch compared to CouchDB. There is no code shared with CouchDB at all. Everything was written from scratch. Even the revision tree algorithm has been rewritten from scratch. It's actually using maps. This is not that it's faster, but the code is more easily to parse and to maintain on a long way. And the other thing that this change allows us is Barrel is actually a library, and you can use it like Amnesia and launch it in your console. So if I can do that in 5 minutes, maybe. up. Okay. So yeah, I forgot to say that Barrel is only compatible with Erlang 18 and Erlang 19. You can't use it even with Erlang 17 because we are using the new random modules and stuff like this. And we are using everywhere maps and stuff that you only have in very recent Erlangs, which makes the code very simpler to implement. So, like I said, this is a pure database, pure Erlang database. So I can start. The database. So I'm using RocksDB there, and when you start the database, you have a default store, or you need to take one of the storage provider you choose. So you can have many storage provider on you. On one node, super, what? Yeah. So you don't have to figure the name of the database, you always use the name of the database as a reference. So I'm starting with a document ID. And of course, I can get a database. Yes, and I can do on the same with curl. Okay, and I will stop there. You have most of the functions. So the HTTP API is working. So you can actually discuss between nodes using that. And coming on Friday, the full replication algorithm will actually work. So you are actually able to replicate between processes. And the main objective for this week is to be able to replicate between nodes on different places. And then we will be good. And in parallel, we have an Android node that is actually written. So you will be able to replicate in Android, then iOS, etc. And if you have some question. Yeah.
Are you allowed to
change the size of the Sorry? Yeah. So it's using workable for Minaka, and Here for a storage provider, the default storage provider, for RocksDB, the default we are setting the same number of actors that you have threads on the database. So actually 71, but if you want more, that. And of course, then you will be able to share the process behind that for the write process. Increasing the number of the size of the pool, yeah. But you can't. In theory, I wouldn't advise to change the storage provider. But anyone want, you can hack and change the storage provider dynamically if you want. So it's totally. This is why you have multiple backends. So in RocksDB, depending on the option you have on startup, you can say, "I want all my data synced on the disk." But if you want, like some customers having a multiple level of storage and say, "I want my data coming first in RAM, mainly in RAM, and then going on the disk from time to time, like release," then you can, for example, text the RocksDB backend and say, "I want to increase the number of." The buffer, the RAM buffer, and put all the data first in RAM and then going on the disk, or going everything in RAM if you want to. Yeah. So, yeah, by default, we are using HTTP and soon WebSockets, but if you want to, you this is just a supervisor started with Cowboy. Behind. Yeah, you can use Erlang distribution, but using just a TCP socket from Erlang. If there is, you can switch off the HTTP backend if it's your question. For now, it's shipped by default. But maybe it's a good idea to put that in a separate repository as a plugin. I don't know if I understood well.
Let's thank Benoit, and don't forget to vote.
Thank you.